So finally, aliens. Could SpaceX's Starship be set of other incredible uses we've been talking about on this channel? Be set allowing us to become a multi-planetary species? Could this very same Starship actually help us to find aliens?
Starship and aliens? How are these topics even connected to each other? Well, I would say, let's find out.
So after the last admittedly quite global politics heavy episode, it's time we start exploring some other interesting topics. And the famous alien guy with his insanely cool hairstyle already taught us long ago that aliens are basically the key to everything. So who are we to argue with him? Now okay, the theory that aliens helped to build the pyramids of Giza, or that the Nazca Plateau was built to help alien ships to land safely, might be a bit exaggerated. Even though we have to say that we like these series for their entertainment value. Still, we are 100% convinced that alien life in the universe is extremely common. It's highly unlikely though that aliens have visited Earth in the recent past. However, not unlikely that they visited our home planet a very, very long time ago, maybe already billions of years ago, when Earth and the solar system looked totally different, when three planets with oceans were circling the sun. Those were the times. Now only one remains.
So why do we think that the likelihood for alien life is basically 100%, 99.999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999 numbers. The Kepler mission showed us that there are tens of billions of rocky Earth-sized planets circling their parent stars in the habitable zone. This is just based on taking the data of the thousands of exoplanets we have already discovered and extrapolating that data to all the stars in the Milky Way. Because Kepler found that almost all stars have planets of some form circling them. A paper, link in the description, attempted to do just that. Based on observations by the Kepler Space Telescope of 42,000 sun-like stars, having found 603 planets, 10 of them having been Earth-sized and in the habitable zone of their parent stars, they extrapolated these findings to 400 billion stars, because that's the incredible number of how many stars there actually are in our galaxy alone. The researchers then arrived at a mind-boggling number of around 40 billion Earth-sized rocky planets in the habitable zone of their parent stars. In this galaxy alone. This is an incredible number. This means that even if the likelihood of life arising on a planet in the habitable zone should be very small, there still would be a very large number of planets that would host life. And recent findings of complex amino acids, alcohols, sugar molecules, and possibly even simple proteins on meteorites shows that the building blocks for life are floating around everywhere in the universe, drifting around on these small rocks, just waiting for the right planets to kickstart life. Because please don't forget that early Earth was a very hostile and unfriendly place. Yet still, despite this, life on Earth started already 4 billion years ago. So basically, right after Earth cooled off, life immediately started.
And we believe that soon we will discover either present or past life on Mars. And most likely, we will also discover life in the subsurface oceans of Europa and Enceladus. So we don't even have to start doing some calculations with the Drake equation to show how extremely likely alien life is. And even should the step to intelligence be super hard, that would still result in probably around 10 to 100 intelligent species in the Milky Way, based on high probability assumptions. Link to a paper which arrives at these numbers using statistical methods and the Drake equation will be in the video description. Oh, and please don't forget that there are trillions of galaxies in the observable universe. Therefore, the numbers are vastly in favor of life. Okay, so now we have established that alien life is extremely likely. So what does this now have to do with Starship? Well, turns out a lot, because Starship could help us to find alien life in two major ways. First, by launching the next generation space telescope, the LuWAR Space Telescope, which is even bigger than the James Webb Space Telescope. And second, by helping us to build giant radio and even optical telescopes on the far side of the moon. And if you think, hey, those two talk about some interesting stuff, starships, and now even aliens, and sometimes even Tesla and other disruptive techs, then why not consider to subscribe to us and stay up to date on those topics?
The LuWAR Space Telescope is a proposed next-generation space telescope, which would be the successor of the famous James Webb Space Telescope. We've often talked about the James Webb Space Telescope because it is already a huge step up from its predecessor, the Hubble Space Telescope. The JWST has a 6.5-meter diameter mirror, so 2.5 times more than Hubble's 2.4-meter diameter mirror. And as the light capture capacity of a telescope is proportional to the square of the diameter, this means that the JWST will offer a bit over 7 times the light capture capability as the Hubble Space Telescope. It will be so powerful that for the first time ever, when it launches in October 2021, hopefully no further delays, we will be able to observe exoplanet atmospheres. It will allow us to even detect biosignature gases in exoplanet atmospheres, which are gases that are a strong indicator for the presence of life, such as, for example, molecular oxygen, so O2, but also water molecules, H2O. And methane, CH4.
It might even allow to trace techno signatures, such as chlorofluorocarbons, which do not exist naturally, but can only be created by technology. But now the LuWAR, of which two variants exist, an 8-meter diameter one and a 15-meter diameter one, called LuWAR-B and LuWAR-A, respectively, would of course be much more powerful. Specifically, the 15-meter diameter one would be a big step up from the James Webb Space Telescope, offering 5.3 times its light capture capacity. This would allow for even more accurate and precise measurement of alien exoplanet atmospheres, so that even further away, and thus many more exoplanets, could be discovered that host biological life of some sort. The LuWAR can even detect infrared and ultraviolet wavelengths, not only visible light. The important thing is now that currently only Starship would allow to transport the larger LuWAR-A into space. The rendering here shows the smaller LuWAR-B, but SpaceX confirmed that Starship could also transport the LuWAR-A into space. No other vehicle would allow for such a payload to be transported into deep space.
So Starship could enable a more powerful next-generation space telescope to be launched into space, which in turn would allow us to find biosignature and technosignature gases. The way this works, by the way, is that the exoplanet being analyzed passes between the telescope and the parent star. Thus, the light of the parent star travels to some extent through the atmosphere of the planet and interacts with the molecules of the planet atmosphere. This leaves very specific absorption and excitation bands at very specific frequencies, which then are detected by the James W. Space Telescope or LuWAR, so that we can measure the existence of such gases with very high precision. But now you might think, hey, LuWAR is nice and fine, but still too small for my taste. Worry not, because Starship will take exobiology to a whole different level. Namely, by allowing us to build giant radio and optical telescopes on the far side of the moon. Radio telescopes on the far side of the moon would not have to worry about any interference from Earth sources, as current Earth-based radio telescopes have to. The far side of the moon would be completely shielded from all Earth radio transmissions, therefore allowing for much better and precise measurements of radio signals. And since SETI, so Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, is trying to find radio signals from intelligent civilizations, having less noise and higher precision would certainly help a lot.
A 1 kilometer diameter radio antenna sounds crazy on Earth, but on the Moon, not so much. Built an array of 100 1 kilometer dishes that can be pinpointed to all destinations, and you got yourself an insanely powerful radio signal finder. And who knows, the next wow signal could be awaiting us. The wow signal is, by the way, our best find of a possible alien intelligence transmission to this day, and was discovered in 1977. And to this day, wild theories are going around to what the origin of this signal could be. But it has all the hallmarks of intelligence, and it is really one of the very few signals which actually could be an intercepted radio transmission from an alien radio beacon or an alien vessel of sorts, flying through interstellar space and communicating with other space vessels or with its home planet. And of course, don't forget that we could also build gigantic, truly gargantuan optical telescopes on the far side of the moon. If you think that ESO's EELT is large, which will have a 39-meter diameter mirror, then you will be certainly very happy to find that a 0.166g gravity on the moon would consequently allow to build telescopes that are up to 6 times bigger. So how about a 235-meter optical telescope on the far side of the moon? And now imagine 10 such telescopes coupled together with interferometry. This would allow for an instrument of such insane power that we could get images of rocky Earth-sized exoplanets circling nearby stars.
So Starship, by allowing us to launch a next-generation space telescope, and by allowing us to build a moon base, or better, moon cities, will thus also allow us to build huge telescopes on the far side of the moon, and therefore greatly accelerate the most important discovery of our lifetimes, namely finding life, and possibly even intelligent life on other planets. And we have the strange feeling that it will happen still in this century. Oh, and our cool friend, the angry astronaut, you know, the grumpy old guy with the sunglasses, made a really cool video about the same topic, so we really recommend you to go and check it out, link in the description, and also to check out and subscribe to his channel. Why? Because he's an awesome guy and makes awesome space videos. And if you think there is no life on Mars, then maybe we should terraform Mars. And you can watch this video here where we explain how this would work.
So thanks for watching the JI Space Report, and I would say, on to the future. I will just say technology to put to make you feel good, even though I'm 100% sure I'm also a bit annoyed because of course you don't believe me. You like aliens a lot.